Hello everyone, my name is Sajal and welcome back to our channel. Here we discuss about tech, career and life. So I have been a software engineer, then a tech lead and a manager at FAANG companies for over 10 years. Today we are chatting about something very important, which is structured communication. You know, in engineering, we always discuss about the cool stuff, all the new programming languages, but we often neglect this very important skill. It is about how we communicate our ideas very clearly so everyone understands us. Not only structured communication helps our stakeholders, but it helps us in how we think properly. It makes us sharper. So are you curious on how to do this better? Let's find out. First, let's explore a fascinating case from Apple's training methods. They draw inspiration from none other than Pablo Picasso. So Picasso embarked on a journey to distill the complexity of a bull into simple, abstract forms. He started with a detailed, realistic sketch, gradually stripping away layers until the only essence remained, a few lines representing the horns, the body, and the legs. This wasn't just an exercise in art. It was about capturing the spirit of the beast. Now, why should we, as software engineers, care about an artist's process? Because it mirrors a powerful approach to communication and problem solving. Just like Picasso, we can strive to simplify complex ideas into their most fundamental elements. This isn't about making things easier to understand for others, but it's about us. How can we make things simple and structured for ourselves? So by focusing on these structures, we can quickly formulate very compelling narratives that are both memorable and persuasive. This is the way to represent complex ideas with clarity and impact. So today, I'm going to talk about four frameworks that help with structured communication. At the end of the video, I'll also talk about which structure can be used in which situation. I use these frameworks on a day-to-day basis, and they have really helped me in my career. I really hope that these will be very powerful for you as well. So the first one is called the problem, solution, and benefit approach. In this communication, you start with the problem. You describe the problem as concisely and as crisply as possible. Next, you talk about the solution. What is the solution to this problem? And then the third is the benefits. You need to highlight the tangible benefits with this approach in the larger, grander scheme of things. So let's take an example. You're part of a team that is writing a big system, and there are lots of engineers who are onboarding. With more engineers, there are more regressions due to bugs that are being deployed. Ultimately, that requires a lot of debugging, and that also slows down the releases. So that is the clear problem that you have described. Now you get to the solution. The solution can be you introduce CI/CD, you introduce integration tests, and that helps in catching these errors in the inner dev loop. So you describe the solution. And now you expand onto the benefits of this approach. The CI/CD and the automated testing that has been built really helps in the developer productivity. You are able to catch these bugs early, so you don't have to debug on later on. It ultimately results in faster releases, and it ultimately has better customer satisfaction because now there are more features that get shipped faster. So here you have clearly described the problem, the solution, and the tangible benefits with this solution. The next one is the sequential approach. Here you talk about the past, present, and the future. So here you describe the initial challenge or situation. Then you come to the present and describe all the changes that have been made and the current state of progress. And then you describe the future, which is the next steps and the future plans ahead. So for example, in your system in the past, there was one query which was particularly slow at the peak hour, and that created a lot of churn for the customers because they couldn't access the website at that time. Today, you have made multiple changes to the backend architecture. You have deployed a new database system. You have added load balancers for the query and so on and so forth, and ultimately reduced that query latency by 70%. And then finally, you talk about the future, that you will add more machine learning algorithms to dynamically predict workloads. You will have throttling for pathological queries and so on and so forth. And then ultimately, all the new improvements will be deployed in 6 to 12 months. So in short, it clearly describes the journey of the project and it gives you a very accurate status update. The next one is the comparison, contrast, and conclusions approach. This is often what we get when we are doing design decisions. So you start off by the comparison, where you start establishing the two entities being compared. So an example can be comparing a relational database with a modern NoSQL database. Then you go to the contrast, where you dive deep into the differences and similarities between the two entities being compared. So for example, a relational database has structured data for data integrity, then complex querying for ACID transactions and so on, while NoSQL databases is schemaless and it scales horizontally, and it's great for adaptability. And then you get to the conclusions, where you draw conclusions based on these entities, the comparisons that you have laid out, the similarities that you have laid out, and then finally, how these two compare for the problem you solve. This serves as a very good communication strategy, especially for design decisions. Here you compare the two entities and then discuss the trade-offs. And finally, you are able to come to a conclusion. This greatly benefits the readers as well, where all the context has been taken into account. So use this for your next design doc. So the next one is a bit more complicated, but I hope it makes sense. This one is called the what, so what, and now what approach. What? You begin by clearly stating the situation or the fact. For instance, in our last sprint, we implemented a new feature that optimized the app's load time. Next, you get to so what. You explain the importance of this development. Why should your audience care? You might say this optimization is crucial because it enhances the user experience significantly. Statistics show that users abandon apps that take longer than 3 seconds to load. Our improvements cut this time by half. Then comes the now what. You conclude by directing your audience towards an action of a future plan. This could be, moving forward, we need to monitor all user feedback closely to see how change affects user retention and satisfaction. So this format helps you deliver your message in a clear, logical progression, ensuring that your audience understands not only what you have done, but also what's important and what needs to be done next. It's a powerful way to keep communication actionable and purpose-driven. So finally, here is my pro tip. This is about when I use which technique, and it really shines in that situation. So let's start with the problem, solution, and benefit approach. I really use it when I have to persuade the team for a new direction. It really helps in pitching for new ideas because you can describe a problem, then solution, and the benefit in the longer run. So the next one is sequential. I use it when I'm explaining the history of a product or a system. I outline the evolution of technology through a training session, and it really helps me motivating the team as well as giving strategic direction. Then the third one is the comparison contrast conclusions. I already said this, but evaluating different technologies or adoption of different proposals is when this technique comes in really powerful. Here you can describe the different approaches and then make a decision. So this one is for decision making. And the last one, which was the what, so what, and what now. This one is really good for status updates. Here you can update a team on the project status, teaching a concept in the team, and explaining the impact of this change in the longer run. This is a very powerful technique, which is essential for meetings, presentations, and educational content, because it is about providing important information in a very precise and concise manner. So thank you all. If you like this video, do share and subscribe to the channel. We will be routinely coming up every week with new topics of discussion that can help you in your career as well as life. Stay tuned for the next one. See you. Bye-bye.